education led to a job because I became editor of a school newspaper. It was a bit of a disreputable school newspaper. The head teacher didn't like it. But when I left school, I got a job straight away as an apprentice journalist on the Cambrian News, the West Wales weekly newspaper. It was a very exciting time, a wonderful opportunity, and I actually turned down a place, the offer of a place, in Aberystwyth University to take it. And I think, well, I know that I learned more there than I would have done in a classroom in a journalism course. Had there been such a thing as a journalism course in those days, which there wasn't. So I ended up as a reporter with the Cambrian News in my teens, and I was thrown in the deep end. I was an apprentice for a couple of years, learned my trade. I did nothing but write obituaries for the first year, which sounds a bit boring, but it taught me to get my facts right, and it taught me how to deal with people at a very difficult time, which has stood me in good stead ever since. I was a teenage reporter covering a double killing in the village of Llanon, which more recently has formed the inspiration for a short story I've written on the theme of jealousy. Because it was jealousy that led the ex-boyfriend of a 15-year-old girl to stab her to death in her own back garden, and the girl's father too. So I found myself covering that story at a very young age, and that's formed one of my short stories now, in a series of short stories which I've been writing. I think this is true in every profession. You need to know how to deal with people, especially at a difficult time. And once you've done that, you can... I mean, I've spoken to people since then in all kinds of stressful situations for them, and that grounding set me up for that. Very exciting. Every Wednesday, the South edition would roll. There'd be a noise of thunder coming down Grazing Road in Aberystwyth. Bum-buddy, bum-buddy, bum-buddy. I don't know what the residents thought of it, but I suppose it provided employment so they didn't complain. And on the Thursday, then, the North Wales edition would come rolling out of the huge rotary press. And what a thrill for a young reporter to see your story on the front page with your name on it, literally hot off the press. Yes, the printing tradition had changed hardly at all since Victorian times. And the type was literally set in hot metal, in hot lead. It was laid in a big, it was called a form, and it was, printers could read back to front and inside out, and the paper was printed on top of that. People relied on the local newspaper to get their news, which meant we had to get it right. If we didn't, people would come back to us afterwards like a ton of bricks. Shouldn't laugh, but Professor Jack L. Williams, his name was misspelt in the newspaper. And this was one of the worst distinguished educationalists at the time, 1960s. And one of the worst things you could do was get somebody's name wrong or spell their name incorrectly. Jack, he spelled his name without a K. He spelled his name, Professor Jack, spelled it J-A-C. Now the printers in the Cambrian News were convinced this was a mistake. So they kept adding the K in. And when it appeared in the paper, the K would mysteriously come back. So Ken Hankey, the sub-editor, he wrote a little note to the printers, no K. So this'll sort them. A little note to the printers, no K. But of course that's what appeared in the paper. Jack, Professor Jack, no K Williams. Dreadful row afterwards. Family played hell with the owner, Henry Reed. He came running into the newsroom. But it was, it was a shared mistake, which just shouldn't have happened, but very amusing. The editor was Douglas Wright, so in charge of the paper you had Mr. Reed and Mr. Wright. You couldn't make it up, really. Pivotal time for me, because just in advance of the investiture of Prince Charles in, I think it was July 1969, that's right, he came to Aberystwyth to learn a bit of Welsh. I don't think much of the Welsh stuck, but he was there for a few weeks. And the interesting thing for me was that half of Fleet Street's finest, and not so fine, descended on the resort of Aberystwyth. They took over the pubs and hotels and restaurants, and I got to know many of the reporters there. I used to sell stories to them at £50 a time, when I was earning £12.50 a week from the Canberra News. And I realised then that there was a world beyond Aberystwyth. And I always saw myself ending up on the Daily Mirror, because I did quite a bit of work for them. As it turned out, I went to the Western Mail. I moved on to a daily newspaper. I became the Western Mail reporter, based in Aberystwyth, covering the whole of West Wales. If you wanted to know, it was a serious paper of record. If you wanted to know what was happening in Wales, you had to read the Western Mail. There was nothing else. Broadcasting hadn't developed yet. I mean, it was starting to, but it hadn't. When I was there, we had 80,000 readers. That rose to 100,000 soon afterwards, compared, I think, with about 12,000 left today. So quite sad, really. Yes, well, no mobile phones, of course, no computers. The highlight of the day was ringing the news desk at 6 o'clock. And providing you had two good stories to give them, the news editor and everyone would be happy. So they more or less left you to get on with what you wanted to do. It could be a lonely job because you were there entirely by yourself, but you had a good deal of editorial control, editorial freedom. 6 o'clock, I'd ring on the telephone, and there'd be a bank of girls. There were girls in those days, and they'd say, "Copy," and I'd say, "Lewis Aberystwyth," give them the catch line, and every story had to be dictated, word by word. No, there were no fax machines even in those days. Everything was dictated word by word to this army of women. It could take an hour or two. Your whole evening could be consumed by dictating your story. Yes, I wrote three short stories last year. One I've mentioned about the double murder. The other one concerned a story about a missing woman, or at least that's how it started, in the village of Sillian near Lamputa, when I was a Western Mail reporter. I turned up there following up a police appeal for information about a missing woman, or they thought it was a missing woman. I interviewed the husband, who went through what turned out to be a charade of missing his wife and saying what a wonderful woman she was. I had a cup of tea with him in his house. I didn't realise until later that he'd actually hired three hitmen to murder his wife, beat her to death, and bury her body in the garden. So I was sitting there sharing a cup of tea with a man who turned out to be a heartless killer. And the story I've written is based on the theme of the deadly sins, and this one's based on lust. It's based on this guy's lust for another woman, hence his rejection of his wife. Quite content in newspapers, and I loved the medium very much, but I had the chance to move to HTV in 1971, early days still of ITV and ITV News. And I remember well the telegram boy coming to my flat in Aberystwyth, smartly dressed in those days, collar and tie, shiny shoes, cap on his head, and I was whisked off down to Pontcanna in Cardiff for my interview. And I got the job on the strength of a story I'd written for the Western Mail about the closure, or the threatened closure at the time, of the Cambrian Coast Railway line. Our news editor, Stuart Lyshon, had a thing about public transport, because he travelled by bus and train himself. So any story about public transport would end up near the top of his news list. What I did when I heard that the Cambrian Coast Railway line was about to shut — it didn't in the end, but it was about to — I decided to take a bus from Aberystwyth to Pwllheli to see what the alternative bus route would be like if the railway did shut. And there was a picture of me on the front page of the Western Mail getting on the bus, and I wrote about the terrible time I had going from town to town on the bus. Well, Stuart, the news editor in HTV, loved this. And I believe I got the job on the strength of it.